Gandhi's death was witnessed by Vincent Chian. He was an American who became his disciple.
Huh? What?
Good to see you finally joined us, Mr. Anders. Would you like to show the class what you were mumbling about?
Huh? No. You said Chian, right?
That's correct. Vincent Chian. We have a full account of his witnessing Gandhi's death. Is something wrong?
No, no. Sorry to interrupt.
Continuing with the lesson then. Mahatma Gandhi was one of the most influential...
Weirded out when Mr. Mary Cohen said that guy's name.
It's my mom's maiden name.
Your mom's maiden name? You think you're like, this guy's like great grandson or something?
I don't know, dude, but if I am, it doesn't really matter because I'm really exhausted right now.
Gandhi was a spiritual and revolutionary leader of India. In the time of...
Somebody calls you, you answer quite slowly. A girl with kaleidoscope eyes.
Vincent Chian.
I got a taxi and went out to Birla House in time for the prayer meeting. This time I was alone. I stationed my taxi under a tree opposite the gate of Birla House and walked down the drive to the prayer ground. It was not yet 5 o'clock and people were still streaming in on foot, in cars and with tongas. As I came onto the prayer ground at the end of the garden, I ran into Bob Stimson, the Delhi correspondent of the BBC. We fell into a talk and I told him about the journey to Amritsar and what had taken place there. It was unusual to see any representative at the prayer meeting. Bob explained that he had submitted some questions to the Mahatma for BBC. and thought he might as well stay for the prayer since he was on the premises. He looked at his watch and said,
"Gandhi's late. He's practically never late."
We both looked at our watches again. It was 5:12 by my watch when Bob said,
"There he is."
We stood near the corner of the wall on the side of the garden where he was coming, and watched the evening light fall on his shining dark brown head. He did not walk under the arbor this evening, but across the grass, in the open lawn on the other side of the flower beds. It was one of those shining Delhi evenings, not at all warm but alight with the promise of spring. I felt well and happy and grateful to be here. Bob and I stood idly talking, I do not remember about what, and watching the Mahatma advance toward us towards the grass, leaning lightly on one of the two girls, with two or three other members of his family, behind them. I read afterward that he had sandals on his feet, but I did not see them. To me it looked as if he walked barefoot on the grass. It was not a warm evening, and he was wrapped in homespun shawls. He passed by us on the other side and turned to ascend the four or five brick steps which led to the terrace of prayer ground. Here, as usual, there was a clump of people, some of whom were standing, and some of whom had gone on their knees or bent low before him. Bob and I turned to watch. We were perhaps 10 feet away from the steps, but the clump of people cut off our view of the Mahatma now. He was so small. Then I heard four small, dull, dark explosions. I said to Bob in horror,
"Oh my god, what was that?"
"I don't know. Not the Mahatma."
And then I knew. Inside my own head, there occurred a wave-like disturbance, which I can only compare to a storm at sea. Wind and wave surging tremendously back and forth. I remember all this distinctly. I do not believe that I lost consciousness even for a moment, although there may have been an instant or two of half-consciousness. I recoiled upon the brick wall and leaned against it. It was during this time, apparently, that many things happened. A doctor was found, the police took charge, the body of the Mahatma was carried away, and the crowd melted, perhaps urged to do so by the police. I saw none of this. The last I saw of the Mahatma, he was advancing over the grass, in an evening light, approaching the steps.
"Wake up, my great-grandson."
Thank God, it was just a dream.
Look at Mahatma Gandhi, man.
Mahatma Gandhi.
No. Wait, that's not funny. So do not worry about it.
Yeah, dude.